What's up, bro?
We can stop there, right? Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pugliafito. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to listen to your phone and not the show because we're on an 8-second delay, which means we'll be trying to talk to you, and before you know it, you'll be calling back. Also, lower the volume on your computer or your TV because we don't want to have feedback as well. And if you like, you can give us your first name and location where you're calling from. And as you see, we have continuing our series of getting candidates in New York City on the show. And this week we have Patrick Bobilin. And welcome, Patrick.
Thank you very much, Lou.
You're welcome. And he's running for city council in District 5, which is basically the Upper East Side.
Upper East Side, Roosevelt Island, El Barrio, a little bit of Sutton Place, too. Yeah, you got the whole, sort of East Side, 55th to 96th, Lexington to the river. That's the little vogue that I do when people need to know.
Okay, right. Because then is that District 6 just attached us to the south?
District 4 is just to the west, and I'm a little backwards because everything's backwards.
Okay. So anyway, the first thing is because you're a newcomer into this, but not to activism.
It's true.
Okay. So why don't you just tell our audience a little bit about yourself?
Sure. I've been an activist and organizer for a number of years. I worked on the Bernie Sanders campaign. I worked with Black Lives Matter activists in Chicago. I was also a public school teacher on the South Side there. I worked on several campaigns in the past. I did, signature collecting for different campaigns, and I, canvassed for Jill Stein in Massachusetts when she was running against Mitt Romney in, 2002? I did little things for one of the Ralph Nader campaigns. So I've been sort of at the edges and the fringes of sort of left politics for a lot of years. I got involved with Democratic Socialists of America about 9 months ago, and I started organizing with them, and I got really excited about electoral politics in the city. Mm-hmm. And I saw that in my district there was no one running against the current incumbent. I felt like I had a different value system, and I'm used to activism. I'm used to jumping into a space, and I'm used to leadership roles, and I'm used to advocating for people who have,
So what specifically with Ben Kalos is that kind of irked you to say, I got to run, or is it just because of Trump and you wanted to, help, that whole thing? Is it a combination or?
Partially it was knowing that the Democratic Party needed to have new voices, have new energy and new ideas and new faces. I saw that, people want some level of populism right now. People want elected officials who are willing to go in and willing to fight for the right things. And specifically to the current council member, I would say there are three major things that I'm concerned about. One is in the district, we've seen rampant development of luxury buildings. We're not seeing any move to try to create higher density buildings, even as the population grows around there with the Second Avenue subway. The second thing is the lead crisis that's in our schools. I don't know if you know about this. I mean, you're an environment guy.
I think it's spreading all over.
Yeah. So there's, in all the schools, but especially in our district, they found higher lead toxicity levels in one of our local schools than they found in Flint, Michigan during the height of the crisis. And to me, that's time to act. I spoke with the council member and he told me, there's not enough outcry yet, so it's not a crisis. And to me, this is exactly the kind of politics that we're done with in 2017.
Right.
Post-Trump era, we need action. We need people who are willing to get in there and fight. And so...
to do what? Right.
Exactly. Fight
right.
for what's right.
Right. Not just who yells the loudest, but children are in danger.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a health issue. We need to get something done on this.
We're talking human rights issues here. We're talking, basic human rights issues from another era even. I can't believe that we're even talking about lead in water in 2017. This seemed like something that, honestly, at my age, I felt was resolved by the time I was an adult. But clearly, we don't have people who are courageous enough to take on these infrastructure battles. And the third thing, though, in our district is that, this council member recently voted in lockstep with the city council majority to rezone one of our local parks at the top edge of our district. It's the Marx Brothers Park. And to me, when the concept was is that the private developers were going to create high schools, and then they would create another park. And so we're basically beholden to developers' whims. You know, once again, we're beholden to private profit and private industry to determine what we will get in the end when we're putting on a hierarchy of needs.
You know, like, Patrick,
I could go on.
Yeah, I know, but I'm a native New Yorker.
Yeah.
And I've seen a lot of people coming by.
Yeah.
Saying, we need this, we need to change housing. I haven't seen it change. So what would you be doing if you got onto the city council? What direction or what kind of bills would you want to put out there to help the average middle class and lower income people in the city?
Well, first we need to, with any land that we have publicly, we need to create community land trusts, and we need to make it so we can bring home ownership back to the city. And so this is entails something that's, you know, like Mitchell-Lama or a program like that, but a lot more radical. I think secondly, we need to have a vacancy tax, both commercially and residentially. I think a lot of people invest in Manhattan real estate because it's like the best horse you could possibly put your money on.
Well, it's a lot of speculation.
Yeah, but it's, you know, a lot of people invest their money in empty apartments. We need to make sure that they're giving something back to the communities that they're making money from. Because, you know, I don't think that our homes, housing is a basic human right to me. So I don't think that housing should be something that people are making immense profits off of whilst we have 400,000 NYCHA housing vouchers out there, people waiting in line. We have homeless lists like we haven't seen, and we need new ideas and we need new approaches to resolve it. We need to rezone. We need to create higher density.
I've been around a long time, but how are you going to get other city council members? Or is this an Albany thing?
No, we have to do this within city council, and some of this entails zoning. And so we can change the zoning laws. And so one of the things we need to do is, I hear a lot of people say, because they're tired of the super scrapers and the super tall buildings, so they say, oh, we want to put a height limit in. And that's a great idea. But a lot of the people who are motivated to do that are the ones who are just trying to protect their views from the apartments they have now.
Right.
So what we need to do is we need to create floor-to-floor height limits so that when we have a 210-foot cap on buildings, we don't have 15, 16-foot high apartments going up. You know, we don't end up with 10 floors of apartments. We need a cap of 10 or 11 feet so that we can get 20 floors of apartments in these buildings, because we're seeing higher density, and if we're just creating more luxury apartments, we're premiumizing the housing market.
So so why is the Blasio, you know, so popular, and they get everybody behind him per se, that he's not taking on the real estate interest?
Well, let's be frank. I mean, there's one particular development. The only affordable housing development that's being talked about in the Upper East Side right now is an infill section in the Stanley Isaac Tower, you know, residential area. They want to add a third tower in this tight little area. And the person who, the developer who was awarded the contract is a big de Blasio donor. And I say, you know, here's what I say, though. Let's all be adults. Let's all be honest. Let's put that on the table. This is a de Blasio donor. Great. So you come to us with something better than 50-50, since we know the deal. We know that you're making a profit off of this. They want to do 50% affordable, 50% market rate.
So are you looking to do, like you said, a vacancy tax? Are you looking to, let's say, if corporations or foreign investors come in, there would be a levied a higher tax versus a New Yorker looking to purchase an apartment to somehow offset this?
Absolutely. This would be a sort of amendment to that issue, where I would want developers who don't live within the city of New York to have to pay, you know, higher taxes, and owners and landlords who don't live within New York have to pay a higher tax, because their money that they're making from our neighborhoods is not going back into our neighborhoods.
Right.
So we need to find a way to make sure that money stays in our neighborhood, because our, you know, we should not be at risk of losing our housing whilst people are still making a huge profit.
So you have a certain viewpoint.
I do.
That sets the tone for all your legislation that you want to get at.
Yes.
And that is basic human rights. So let's talk a little bit of that. Mm-hmm. What do you feel the basic human rights are, and how does this city address them?
Housing, healthcare, clean and safe environment, and we can throw education in there too. But I like to stick with those first three.
Okay.
These are basic human rights that should be entitled to everyone. And so we're talking about healthcare now in a new way. It's radical to a lot of people, but it's radical to wealthy people, but you know, the majority of Americans, it's not so radical to say that healthcare is a human right all over the country. All over the world,
right.
And it should be in this country. And so what we're doing is we're taking insurance off of the market. We're taking it out of the financial markets so that we can regulate it and so that we can make sure that everyone has good access to good health care. Yeah. We need to think about housing in a different way. People think of that differently because health care is somehow more abstract than housing. Housing is like a concrete thing. Mm. But we need to also think that housing needs to not be in the market the same way that we have it now, because it is a basic human right. And I think we need legislators who have the courage to say, if you want to make a lot of money as people sleep in the streets, you're going to have to pay into that system so we can get people off the streets, because that's not an equitable society, and that is not the society we want. The system that's been laid out in front of us, the form of capitalism and the direction we've been going, is not working. So clearly we need a new approach.
Well, don't you think that basically the city and the administration and people are kind of like short-sighted? Because with more and more higher rents and so on like that, the tax base erodes. And then could we ultimately wind up like in the 1970s when New York City was going broke?
You're saying with higher rents, the tax base erodes.
Yeah, because the people who pay the bills, the middle class,
leave,
and they're going to go somewhere else.
You know what the argument is for the developers? They say, well, if you tax us too much, we lose the tax base. Everybody's afraid of this tax base. Guess what? It's New York City. This is the cultural center of this country. It's the, you know, it, in a lot of ways, it's the intellectual center of the country. There's so much here. I don't see people leaving en masse because there's an equitable tax system in front of us.
Okay.
I just don't see it.
No, just equitable tax system. But what we're getting at is that
equitable
you just
meaning.
Because almost you almost sold this if we should charge more money because you say, no, this is the best place in the world to live.
Oh, no. Well, yeah, that too. Yeah,
no, but true. Yeah, the point is, New York City is one of the richest cities in the world. And we can't accomplish, like you're saying, the basic rights of a home for someone, putting food on the table, and health care, and so on. So we need to go out and change this. Mm-hmm. And you feel that Ben Collins is not the guy. But you know what? He put out great garbage cans. Did you see those on each corner?
It's great. He says he's for recycling. He wants to expand recycling and get to zero waste. You don't do that through single stream, though. And those garbage cans are single stream, meaning to the viewers at home, you don't have your paper, your cans, and your regular trash separated. It's just one big old trash can that everything goes in.
But it's a small hole, so it's hard to jam things
in. Yeah. Fully contradictory to it's a words and deeds issue, where the words say one thing. You know, people on the street are like, he's so nice, he does so many things, because he telegraphs every time he does his job.
You got to sell yourself sometimes.
I understand that, but I mean, you got to be beholden to something at some point.
And I think that there should be a scorecard saying, okay, with housing, but what have you done? And with education, with the health in the schools. And also what I've seen that part of your basic thing is wages and benefits, or wages and benefits is for city workers?
I'm not sure which issue you're talking about necessarily.
I know. I was gleaming over your website, and I saw something about basic. I support protected pensions and
absolutely
and the people, competitive wage for the city workers,
because so many of our city workers, I mean, you've seen these news stories over the last few years of city workers who are homeless and living in their cars.
It's nuts.
This is because, you know, I not to get too deep in the weeds here, but
I'd like to stop you, Patrick.
We have a call.
Yes, we do.
I'm excited.
Hello, you're on Decent Life.
Hey, how are you?
Fine, thanks.
Hi, caller.
You have a question for us? Oh, for Patrick?
Yeah, I'm really, I'm really concerned with you know, the metro system and the rates. The fares keep going up constantly, and the trains are constantly breaking down. So, you know, this is a serious problem affecting every New Yorker, and disproportionately affecting poor people. So what can we do about that?
Mm. Okay, thanks a lot for your call, Patrick.
Well, it's an issue right now that you see the MTA issue is something the governor and the mayor are batting back and forth as if it's your fault, it's their fault. I think first we need to make sure that there are fewer mayoral appointments. These mayoral appointments to head departments need to be elected officials, one. The second thing, the quickest way we can...
MTA people you're talking about who mayor appoints... need to be elected to
absolutely,
that.
Okay. Absolutely, because the people need a voice over that. The second thing, we could quickly alleviate... Let me stop. One of the big issues that's facing our trains is overcrowding right now. They're seeing record ridership. But meanwhile, they're cutting back on all of our buses, especially on the east side. So what we need to do is not cut back the buses, but expand the buses. We have to have dedicated bus lanes during peak hours, and we have to have a priority green lighting system. Do you know about this? It's where the bus gets the green light first, and it gets the green light longer. So that means that we end the congestion and the bunching of buses. We can have better bus service, faster bus service, and it's an attractive option all of a sudden. People are getting out of the subway, and they'll still take the bus across town, where now I grab my select bus service ticket and I start walking. I look over my shoulder to see if there's a bus coming, but by the time I see a bus, I'm already at my destination.
Yeah, but also I think one of the coolest points is that when is the race is going to stop? You have poor service, but we're getting more and more, you know, prices increases. Because right now, what is it, $2.75?
Yeah.
A fare, you know, I used to take it for like 10 cents.
Well, we definitely need to support the mayor's, you know, sudden altruism to, you know, even though it's against what he decided just a few months ago, to create, you know, free metro cards to low-income people. I'm for that, absolutely, 100%.
Do you think that the there should be an investigation into the MTA and see what the heck they're doing? Because, you know, one time
absolutely.
they had two books. They actually have two books. So when they go to negotiation, I don't know if you're familiar with that, but they did. But, you know, it's going to go up, and especially... It's another thing that eats at your paycheck.
Mm-hmm.
Because the three main things that eat at your paycheck is housing, transportation, then you got food, and then you have your education.
Healthcare. You said two things. See how quickly it adds up?
It grows.
Yeah.
And what occurs to me, are you for unions? Because the way you're talking...
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. So most of the city employees are unionized, or are they... They are unionized.
Yeah, I think there's a union for the MTA, yeah. I've actually been working with one specific union right now, the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, IBEW Local 3, in their fight against Spectrum. After the merger between Charter and Time Warner Cable, they proposed an idea where all of the sort of 10-year, 20-year veterans of the company, they would enter the sort of corporate hierarchy at year one. All of a sudden, they would lose their benefits and they would be given a nominal raise. But meanwhile, you know, they're making record profits. I think they paid their CEO $99 million last year as a bonus. And these guys have been striking for almost 5 months now.
And you know what? You really don't see that much in the news, except for the time when the guy was. What was he in Queens cutting the
service? Well, I mean, that's the whole thing about corporate monopolies. It's hard to criticize the corporation if the corporation owns the medium with which you would criticize them, being the channel. The mayor's making some lip service right now, which I really do appreciate. I appreciate the mayor's taking up the idea. But what I want to see is him end the city's... The city has a franchise agreement with the company. And that's where, you know, they could be holding the purse strings and they're not really acting where they could be.
Okay, so we talked about a lot, but I want to make sure I covered everything that you know it's near and dear to you on the show here. Have we?
There's a couple of things. I think, you know, I want to begin the conversation about finding a way to pay domestic workers and stay-at-home parents. Because, you know, without these are the kinds of ideas, much like reproductive rights, that give people sort of economic liberation, and you know, give people the opportunity to.
You know, a lot of people say, well, they have that already. You know, women who are not married and have children are getting stay-at-home parents.
Right. But because of the cost of childcare,
yeah.
and meanwhile, you know, the different public programs are picking up the slack. We need to figure out a way for the future to create this. I mean, we have even Mark Zuckerberg talking about a universal basic income.
So wait, what you want? Universal basic income meaning? Yeah.
Meaning that everyone's entitled to some amount of income, since you know. They pay into the tax base. These aren't, people want to say that these are entitlements. I would say they're earned credits people have. When someone gets unemployment, that's not an entitlement. That's something they earned through their work.
Yeah.
They paid into it. They get something back when they need it. So,
but that's interesting. Stay-at-home parents. It's like when I was growing up, you know, one parent stays home and that. So is that what you're looking at to do, is to have one stay home and get paid? Or is it, can they both go to work or something? I'm not sure what we're getting at.
Well, I think it's so that we're not, you know, we have this sort of exploitative, you know, black market of, you know, it's not the worst thing in the world, but of child care workers who are often underpaid and overworked. You know, if we could subsidize the childcare costs for families and for stay-at-home parents, then we allow some economic liberation. I would also say another thing that I want to add to the governor's SUNY-CUNY idea of free college is, you know, along with public tuition, we need housing vouchers and childcare vouchers, because otherwise that free tuition only goes to people who can already afford housing and already afford childcare, or who are young. And I think, you know, in order to create a better society and say mm-hmm. that these opportunities are for all people, we have to make sure that we're thinking of all people.
Okay. So if we're going to go that way, that means more tax revenue need.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you going to bring the additional tax revenue in? Are you looking for a different type of tax structure?
Yeah, it was a more progressive tax structure where we're taking more money from the 1% and we're redistributing it to the lower income people who need it.
Well, you know, if I was working and I'm being successful, I would say to myself, why? I would, you know.
Sure.
You
for a functioning society. Look.
Yeah, no, right, no, but it's I think that what we're heading is that there's not enough money for everyone. And
I'll give you my personal experience if you want, if I may.
No, you can. No, okay, go ahead.
My personal experience is I grew up on public assistance. I grew up really poor. My okay. mom was a single working parent, worked 50 hours, you know, 50 hours a week to try to get mm-hmm. us to survive. I went to college, still poor. I got out of college, still poor. I taught myself engineering. I was suddenly making six figures.
Mm-hmm.
I looked at my paycheck, and I look how much taxes were taken out, and I said, you know what? I get Republicans, but I also want a functioning society. I want public schools, because I know that the issues of crime and the issues, you know, that they, you know, that people would also complain about can be resolved if people's basic needs are met. And so if we are willing to realize that, you know, people need to pay their fair share mm-hmm. to have a good functioning society where people are cared for and we're just happier in general.
I think that's where the whole argument comes in. What's a fair share? Because I look at it as, you know what, my fair share is 5% and your fair share is 5%. And why should I pay more? But that's another issue, and not for the city here, because you know what, you got to go to the state government and also to the federal government again to make changes like that. But also I'm looking, because you know, over in other cities like in Portland and so on, they are actually limiting the CEO salaries and something like that. So mm-hmm. do you think we should actually go towards a more of a wage adjustment, maybe making a $20 minimum wage in the city?
I think we need higher than that, honestly. I think we need a $25 minimum wage, because right now in New York, it costs about $25, $26 an hour. You need to be making $25 or $26 an hour to afford a two-bedroom apartment as a single person. So that means that single working parents need to make that much money in order to have a private bedroom from their kids. I grew up at one point living, you know, sharing a bedroom with my mom because we were super poor.
Yeah,
and, you know, So she didn't. She was working her butt off, but we weren't making that kind of money. And so if we continue to pay people such a low wage, we're basically saying they deserve to have a crummy life. They deserve to have that. And if we are willing to say that, no, everyone deserves some level of dignity. Single parents deserve privacy at the end of the day from their kids to have their own bedroom.
That's right.
You know, for mental well-being, for physical well-being. Then
that's
we
right.
need to be
and
courageous.
And integrity to provide for your own family.
Absolutely.
You know, and not have to eat crap, per se, to get things done.
People are working 40 hours a week and they're homeless.
I'm for you
this
with
is
that.
Nuts.
Because, you know, I'm same as you. Every honest, hardworking person deserves a decent life.
They deserve a home. They deserve a roof over their head. And they deserve health care.
That's right. In retirement as well.
Oh, of course.
Okay, Patrick, we've got about a minute left. Is there anything that you would like to say or...
Well, you know,
to wrap this up,
yeah,
because you're a pretty talkative person. So.
I am. I hope that's a
good way for me not asking questions.
Oh, is there something that you need to ask? Or
no,
leave something
no,
off
no,
you?
No. It's fine, but I like the one about the stay-at-home parents.
Yeah, I've never been happier right now to be in public service. The conversations that I have, I'm not making money or anything, but I'm saying the public sphere and with the ability to advocate for issues and the ability to talk to constituents, I've never been happier in an odd way.
I got one question. Why aren't more people out in the street?
What do you mean out in the street? Riding?
Yeah, you know, you ever see the movie, was it Broadcast News or whatever? The guy has a breakdown.
I'm mad as hell, I'm not going to take it
that's
anymore.
That's right, open your window. We don't see the average person doing
because
that.
Because the Democratic Party has made it so hard. The Democratic Party controls the city, and, you know, a lot of people just assume, oh, it's a Democratic Party, it's better than the Republicans, so I don't need to be involved.
I want more people out running and yelling and screaming.
But that's absolutely what we need, and so we need election reform, we need voter reform, we need to open this process up to a lot of people. I made a video, it's up on my website, about the petitioning. And petitioning, as you know, trying to collect your 4,000 signatures, it's you stand around,
and Patrick, you know what I know.
Door to door.
I'm wrapping up the show now, but you know what? With you running and your ideas, you know, we can stop the rain. And all we need is love. Thank you,
all
Patrick.
All we need is love. Thanks everybody for watching.
Good night.
Thank you.